Monaco Pizza presents SCP. Check this. The Steve Dangle Podcast with your hosts, Steve Dangle and Adam Wilde.
I know that there's lots of important, exciting hockey going on right now, but what you need to know to start this show is that Steve almost died this weekend.
I did?
Almost died.
How did I almost die?
The night before, we were due to play with the CWHL All-Stars.
Yes.
In our road hockey tournament.
Paved the way.
We decided to go out to the bar and have a drink or two, go over strategies like one does.
Yes.
And unfortunately, Steve had to get into the back of my car. at which point, Steve informed Jesse and I.
Did you know that it's just amazing? I'm so proud of my friend. You know, he does so many things. He does this podcast. He does Kiss 92.5. He does breakfast television. And I didn't know this, but he actually also works for the circus. Because I got into his clown car. I just packed right in there. I accidentally sat right down in that clown horn he's got. And yeah, I almost died every time he went over a bump.
I drive a two-door car. Yeah, so the back seat's a little smaller.
You own a clown car.
Oh, thank you, Jesse, for coming around.
My leg was starting to fall asleep because I was sitting there and I was so cramped.
Well, yeah, Jesse in that car looks like the guy from The Simpsons. Do you find something comical about my automobile?
I think everybody in that car looks
like that. Wave to the people. Blow them kisses. No, it was great because you jerks picked me up. Jesse's in the passenger seat like, yeah, Steve, what's wrong with you? Bumping your head in the seat. And then later when we picked up Andrew Jerkshire, Jesse's in the back like...
Just totally, up. Oh, well, I didn't buy that car for the backseat. It happens to have one, but it's more for it's a two-seater car that goes fast.
Just two or three of the seats are for decoration.
Yeah, no, yeah. Or just putting stuff on. Car. It's good to put stuff on.
Yeah, to fit the other 18 clowns that squish into the back. That's what it's for.
So Steve gets in the back anyway and says, "My head is right up against. If you get into an accident, I'm going to die." And I thought that might have been a slight overreaction.
Jesse?
Given that.
Nope.
No! Oh, I knew it was too good to be true.
What? Wait.
He agreed with me on something.
No, Steve is correct.
Oh, wow.
Yes!
It's not an overreaction as well as saying no.
There would have been death.
Yes.
I would have been death.
You would have been dead.
It would have been the Adam Wilde podcast.
Wow. Damn, that would be really boring. Just all the hot takes. Just spewing hot takes and no one throwing anything back at me.
So, here's what I think about this. Anyone in the room disagree? Oh, so, there's no one else in the room. I'm correct.
Myself?
Oh, yeah!
I would be both Stephen A. Smith and that other guy who he's no longer working with.
The bad guy from The Mask.
Exactly.
Skip Bayless.
So true. All right. Forget the Pens. And Tampa Bay Lightning for a second. Forget that other series that's happening in the West that no one's paying attention to anyway.
Rude.
Let's talk about the Toronto Marlies and the Albany Devils. Seventh game.
Yes.
Of all the games, there was two games last night, them and then Pittsburgh-Tampa. It was damn exciting.
Man, this playoff run has had a few really exciting games for the Marlies. There was one where they were... They were down 4-1 in the second period, and they tied the game before the end of the second period.
Wow.
And in this one, it was just a wild third period. Connor Brown scored a shorty in the first, put the Marlies up. Devils tied it. Third period, the Devils go up, and they were still up with about 11 minutes to go. It was 2-1 Devils with 11 minutes to go, a little less than 11 to go. And the game ended 4-3 Marlies.
Yeah. Yeah, and the strangest, I think, fact of all is that Rich Klune scored the game winner.
Oh, it was beautiful. So the Devils tied it up 3-3 with a little less than 5 to go, and I'm like, that's it. We're going to overtime for sure. Soshnikov, who I think was a game-time decision to even play in the game, fires a puck wide. I don't know if it was on purpose or not. It kind of looked like it. Fires it wide. Klune tracked it. All the Devils did not. Klune knew where it was. They didn't. It bounces off the end boards right in front. Bangs it in past Scott Wedgwood with 2:30 left. That's your game. Rich Klune.
Of everybody on the roster, he would have been the last guy I would have picked to score that goal.
I think he would have agreed with you. The guy, it was his first of the playoffs, but he was fired up.
He
was fired up coming
Good
into the
Selly.
Game. Oh, the Selly, but like I guess if you're not from the GTA, you might not know this, but the Marlies... When they walk onto the ice, they just walk through the concourse. like fans just gather on both sides and go, woo!
High five them.
Yeah, and high five them and go nuts. They were all really reserved, you know, just, you know, tunnel vision, walking in, into the arena, except for Rich Clune, who was looking fans directly in the eye and going, too fast, too strong, too fast, just going up and down, going nuts, and he gets the series-winning goal.
What I found so interesting about last night is the Marlies, you know, have been dominant all season. People were talking about how they were, they had the best winning percentage for a while. I don't think they finished with it in professional sports. I think that was the Golden State Warriors that, but for a while there, the Marlies had this incredible winning percentage and it was an amazing season.
First place and in the AHL by a long shot, yeah.
As I drove home from trampoline dodgeball last night, I'm listening on the radio and all I can think is, wow. It's one all. It comes down to, all of this comes down to one period.
Mm-hmm.
And then I thought, that is exactly what happened to the Capitals too. You know, you go hard all year. You have this just beautiful, shiny diamond of a record, right? Like it's just incredible. And even so, even with all that effort, it can still come down to the last 20 minutes.
Well, and I got to give credit to cameraman Al. Super producer Al, Alessandro Labolsimo, he helped me shoot the Josh Donaldson interview this morning, which I guess maybe we'll talk about a little bit. But gotta pat ourselves on the back. We did a video heading into the playoffs about what do the statistics say? We took stats that all five of the last Stanley Cup winners share. And this year, after the regular season, there wasn't a team that met all four criteria that we came up with. But there were three teams that tied with three.
Okay.
Pittsburgh, who's still in the Final Four.
Mm-hmm.
Tampa, who's still in the Final Four.
I'd heard that.
And the Washington Capitals, who ran into another one of the three teams. So
interesting. Nothing for the West?
No, it was just, well, no, the Blues. Oh, wait, what did I say?
You said Washington, Pittsburgh, Tampa.
I was mistaken. Sorry, it wasn't Tampa. It was Washington, Pittsburgh, St. Louis.
Okay.
Washington, Pittsburgh, St. Louis.
Still pretty cool.
Still pretty cool, and but like you said, it just wasn't the right matchup for them.
Sometimes
doesn't mean they suck. Doesn't mean they're a team worthy of being knocked out in the second round.
No, and it was funny. You know, I was listening to Leafs. I was listening to Hockey Central at noon, and they were talking about how they thought Pittsburgh had the easier run. If I heard that right,
what?
Yeah, and I thought, wait a second. Wait a second. Hold on. So Pittsburgh's had the easier run of the cup? I don't think so.
They had the easier first round.
Yeah.
But then they played Washington.
But Tampa still only had, and no offense to Detroit, but only had Detroit in the first round.
It was a nasty series, but they made quick work of them.
Yeah.
And then the Islanders, I don't know, kind of, it wasn't quite as nasty, and they weren't able to put it together.
I thought Pittsburgh-Washington, that beats them all, to me. That's the trump card right there.
Yeah, and I mean, whoever comes out of the East, I think you could maybe argue that about, because Pittsburgh's heading into the series only played 10 games and Tampa 11. In the West, it's been a longer road, especially if you're the Blues.
Right.
Poor guys.
Well, just dragging their way through. And they have won their first game of the Western Conference finals, if you've been paying attention. But, you know, the thing about that series is that versus the Tampa Bay Pittsburgh series, I don't think either team in that series, no matter who won that game, was going to feel too down on themselves. They both strike me as teams that are pretty mentally tough, and I feel like San Jose is just not, they're just not a team that you trample on, right? They're not in a I think that they'll be back, and they'll be back real strong.
Boy, they got some aging parts, man. The Blues don't really, you know, not too badly, but Thornton. But he's so good still. Age says he should be declining. His numbers say LOL.
Yeah. Well, and that's the interesting thing. That's why San Jose, to me, you know, they're not a team that I would have even, I think I would have picked them to fight for a playoff spot. I was absolutely wrong about them.
Heading into the season, yeah, I probably would have said the same thing, and I picked the Kings to beat them in round one.
As
but I had a Capitals Ducks Stanley Cup final.
Still might get one half of my Stanley Cup final, by the way, because I believe I took Tampa Bay.
Tampa, so, Chicago?
Yeah, I said Tampa, Chicago. I'm fairly sure.
Oh, wow. You were the only one in this room who had Chicago.
Maybe I was Washington. Yeah. My heart said Tampa, but my brain said Washington, so I probably went Washington.
I love that none of us have checked our brackets.
No,
why bother?
Why bother? We haven't even talked about the fact that we did a bracket challenge.
We should probably, later in the show, we should like look up who's winning.
By the way, we're going to figure out a prize for that, so if you are entered, don't worry. We'll give you a prize for that. There is a prize to be had.
Yes.
Yeah, we should check that out and just see how we did, because we're all out.
There is a new X factor in this series, though. In the San Jose St. Louis series. Vladimir Tarasenko, good player. Do we all agree?
Agree. He is.
Yes.
He is sort of Russian, though.
He is sort of Russian.
He's got that Russian thing happening, which, as a Canadian, offends me.
He's got a little bit of that Russian. But I tell you what else he's got. A little bit of that dad strength. He just became a dad.
Oh.
So he is.
Damn.
I'm expecting hat tricks in each of his remaining playoff games.
There's something about that dad strength.
Something about that dad strength. I did a video about it last year, and I looked through it, and it was actually pretty incredible, the record that these players had after they had a kid. Well, I mean, they didn't give birth to the kid, but, you know, Grabowski, I think, was the highest scoring player in the NHL, like ahead of Sidney Crosby when he was with the Leafs, like the month after he had his first child. Patrick Sharp had a ridiculous game, and they're all kinds of guys.
That's funny.
Yeah, I'll have to repost that video.
That is really weird.
I don't know how it works. Well, and especially because like most of them go on no sleep.
Yeah,
I think they're just super punchy, and it's the adrenaline and you know, they've been training for so many years. Whatever is committed to muscle memory, they just do. And like, that's the purest stuff. And so maybe they don't overthink.
Are you
better? So, it's just a fluke.
Are you saying right now that you think St. Louis is the team that gets through that series?
Adam, I don't think I said that. That would be the Dangle jinx.
You said San Jose's old.
Well, you know what? I did pick San Jose to win it all, didn't I? But now that I know the X factor, yeah, go ahead and scream, Blues fans. I think I'm going to have to pick the Blues.
Wow. Wow.
just so there's no confusion, I'm picking the St. Louis Blues to beat the San Jose Sharks.
You should put that in your bio on Twitter. Now, are
delete
you,
everything yeah, else.
Are you just reverse Dangle jinxing?
I don't know what you're talking about. I am simply
want San Jose to get through.
I don't know what you're
saying.
I think this guy's cheering for James Reimer.
I am simply stating.
That's right. He would never cheer against James Reimer.
I am simply stating a fact.
He knows the power of the Dangle.
He wants Reimer and Polak in the finals because he wants
Nick Spaulding.
Nick Spaulding as well.
Tarasenko has dad strength.
I don't think so.
And I'm just saying.
He almost tried to slip one past him. Nice pickup.
Nothing is going to stop Tarasenko unless he runs into a hot goalie from Winnipeg. Nothing is going to stop him. Nothing.
Or a high goalie formerly of the Los Angeles Kings.
Reimer was never on the Kings. That was Scrivens, Adam. That was Scrivens.
You're right.
Don't get your 2013 Leaf goalies mixed up.
So we've got Tampa Bay and we've got Phil. And the rest of the Penguins. I mean,
who has 35 points in 35 playoff games.
That's the way.
Wow.
Not only is that impressive in the regular season, in the playoffs where everything goes up a notch, that's just mind boggling. Yeah. That really is. That's amazing.
Everyone was going crazy for Kane looking at his playoff numbers over his career. I know Kessel's sample isn't nearly as much, but through 35 games, he's a point a game in the playoffs. That's very, very good. You can't take that away from him. You can't.
Sorry. No, but he's not a big game performer, Steve.
Oh, absolutely not. Absolutely not.
No, I mean,
God, it's going to be just happen. The story that the hockey world needs to happen, just happen.
I was thinking if you missed it, there's a guy named Mike Darnay who tweeted Steve at the beginning of the season and said,
No, it was after the July.
Yeah. And he said, if the Pittsburgh Penguins make the Stanley Cup Finals, I will buy myself and Steve Dangle a ticket. And he's keeping to it.
And Steve and Jesse. Adam and Jesse.
Yeah. And Adam and Jesse, too. So we have proposed that, you know, whenever Steve goes down for that Stanley Cup playoff game, should it happen, not playoff game, finals game, we would go down and, you know, be at a local bar or go to the game.
what was it? Podcast Pittsburgh party?
Yeah,
the PPP.
The PPP.
That's right.
Steve's PPP.
I'm really glad I thought of that name.
Yeah, me too. It's really catchy. Three P's in a row.
Yeah, it's so good that it wasn't taken.
Yeah,
you're absolutely right, Justin.
I like that.
Yeah. Steve's PPP.
I think that if we end up going to the game where the Pittsburgh Penguins have a chance at winning the cup.
Where they do clinch it.
Or they do clinch it. I say we have a hot dog party afterwards.
Hot dog party.
And you know where we do it? We do it right on, is it the Monongahela? Like one of the rivers that is like, there's like a river right in front of the baseball and like PNC Park and Heinz Field. So we have to have Heinz ketchup because...
Never been to Pittsburgh, so I don't know what you're talking about.
Okay, so there's three rivers that intersect in Pittsburgh. So one of them, you can, like, people tailgate along that river, and it'll be warm enough. So we'll get, an electric barbecue, and we'll just have a big old hot dog party.
Oh, big.
BYO hot dog.
Giant sausage fest, everyone.
Yeah, because...
Come to the PPP hot dog party! The PPP sausage fest!
You see? Because...
Put a little mustard on it.
That's right. I'm just saying.
Do we boil of the hot dogs?
No, because we gotta cook them like they cook them out. Don't they cook them on a mini grill?
Yeah,
on
but
the
we could boil them.
If you show up late, don't worry, you can catch up. I'm sorry. That's what I've been laughing at for the last couple.
Oh man, I bet they'd relish the opportunity. So let us have it, Pittsburgh.
Oh, and lettuce.
Yeah, that goes with lettuce.
You got greedy. You tried to sneak one in.
Okay. Anyway, I think this is shaping up to be a good time.
Yes. Adam was caught hot dogging.
Oh! Who sausaged that coming? No.
Okay. I'll give you credit for trying.
Nothing.
That was good.
I tried.
But in all honesty, that's...
Jesse's a high percentage shooter. Adam and I are just firing pucks wide all the time.
Absolutely.
Jesse only shoots when he knows he's got one.
So
probably a good way to be.
That series is tied 1-1.
Yes.
And
after Wiley rookie Sidney Crosby scored in overtime.
That's right.
Have you seen the gif of the curve on the shot?
No.
It's incredible. I'll tweet it out.
Justin Bourne, before he became the Marlies video coach, he did a lot of these blogs called Systems Analyst, and he wrote one about Phil Kessel's shot, and I think the title was the only reason Phil Kessel's shot is good is because it's amazing, or something along those lines. But he also wrote one about Crosby's shot, if I'm not mistaken.
And really?
He's got a really weird... He does have a weird shot, this weird kind of snapshot thing, but like, how do you curve a puck? I still get like confused whenever I see someone curve a soccer ball. Like, how do you do it?
The physics work the same as that movie with Angelina Jolie where she curves the bullet.
It's the exact same physics.
Yeah. See, I thought you were going to
flick your wrist and bullets curve.
That's how it works for sure.
Mm-hmm.
I thought you were referring to Keira Knightley's role in Bend It Like Beckham.
No. that movie.
Dare you, sir? That was a cinematic.
We all know Lindsay Lohan. No, Amanda Bynes has the greatest soccer movie of all time.
What one's that?
I don't know what you're talking about.
The one where she's she dressed up like a boy.
I'm looking up
she
here.
Plays.
She's the man.
Greatest soccer movie of all time.
I do remember that.
All time.
She has a bowl cut throughout the whole thing. Yep. She actually, it's funny, because she is the prettiest looking boy you've ever seen, but she does look like a boy.
Yeah.
Like, it's the weirdest.
And she plays with the dudes, and then they find out she's a girl, and they're like, girls can play too.
So, wait. So
they don't shun her.
No.
So it's Soccer Mulan?
Soccer Mulan.
Mulan?
It's totally Soccer Mulan. Yes.
But better.
But,
Amanda Bynes is in it.
Disagree. There is war in Mulan. And
you'll
fights.
Bring honor to us all. Sorry, I don't know why I know that song. It's from Mulan. Please sing with us all.
All right, guys, so we're going to put your podcast on the radio. I don't know if that's really going to...
It'll go great. It'll be great. People will love it.
Oh, Jesse's just showing me that's silly. Man, I hope that guy makes a lot of money.
Who are you talking about?
Sidney Crosby. He makes a lot of money for shooting pucks in
nets.
That
is unbelievable.
And
now
things like of that nature.
So Tampa Bay goes in. They win the first game against Pittsburgh in Pittsburgh. Okay, then they lose the second game in overtime. If I'm Tampa Bay, and I think Strawman is now back and will be playing his second game in Tampa Bay.
Yes,
and will be getting better. If I'm Tampa Bay, I feel pretty good about that.
Oh, definitely. I mean, I think Drouin had a quote after the game where, like, yeah, we did take one there, but we could be up 2-0 going into our barn. You know? So that will still eat at them. But, you know, you take 24 hours of cool down, you realize, okay, now we have a chance to, you know, go back to Pittsburgh up 3-1.
Right. Well,
never know.
If I were Sidney Crosby right now, I'd be paying a lot of attention to how Jonathan Drouin works so hard.
Oh, absolutely.
Wouldn't you?
His work ethic.
I might even take lessons. I might. That was NBC's. That was NBC's Jeremy Roenick.
That was a chestnut roasting on an open take. Oh, it was brutal. So brutal. But you know what?
I wanted to find the audio of it, but I could not find a good file. And I'm sorry. It's so funny to hear. Jesse, if you find a good file on that, look at, because I think it's worth hearing. Because when Jeremy Roenick says something, Jeremy Roenick has the and this is not to compare them too much, but he has the Donald Trump, I believe every word that is coming out of my mouth and you should too, convincing nature, right? Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter how wrong he is. You believe him for some. Or you,
I am America, and so can you.
Exactly. Do you have it? Amazing.
1 second.
Send it over to me on Facebook.
He basically said, Sidney Crosby.
That's it. No, that's exactly what he said. Oh. If I were Sidney Crosby right now, I'd watch the work ethic that Jonathan Drouin has on a nightly basis.
Now, I've pondered this. I've pondered this a lot over the last, since I've seen it. Mm-hmm. Is he just trying to make compelling TV? Like, if Sidney Crosby doesn't score the OT winner, are we even talking about that comment?
Yeah, I think we're still talking about that comment.
Yeah?
I think we're absolutely still talking about it.
What if Jonathan Drouin scores the OT winner?
I still think we're talking about that comment. Because you're talking about a player.
And how right it is.
You are talking about a player who walked out on his team when his team wasn't playing him to his satisfaction. Let's hear JR say it.
Jim Ross.
I'd watch the work ethic that Jonathan Drouin has on a nightly basis, and especially tonight. Watch this. If I was Sidney Crosby right now, I'd watch the work ethic that Jonathan Drouin has on a nightly basis, and especially tonight. Watch this.
And if you want to, it's on Pete Blackburn's Vine, and you can just watch it over and over again.
Oh, nothing gets by Pete.
No. Pete's dude, good, man.
If
How
I was a hot
this?
Takeist, I'd be like, friggin' Pete Blackburn.
Yeah. Pete Bat.
A
he
hot
is,
takeist?
He is a
hot takeist.
He's hot take police right there. He literally is. He keeps you honest.
I think he has a new Twitter name.
Hot Take Police.
Hot Take Police. The HTP.
The thing about that comment is that it is, yes, Jonathan Drouin is playing really well.
Totally.
But to make compelling TV, one does not have to go as far as to call out the best player in the world's work ethic. Now listen, and this isn't just the best player in the world recently. This is the best player in the world for 10 years.
Since 2005.
Yeah. So you're now going to compare a guy who's played 100 NHL regular season games, maybe?
Something like that.
And 10 playoff games? 11, 12?
Like, more than that. More than that, I think.
Drouin has more goals than Crosby this series.
Wow!
He works harder.
Jesse, you're right. And the Leafs should draft Laine. Same thing.
Done.
Because he's having a better tournament at the IIHF's Zeppler Helmet Championship Memorial.
While we're at it, I think at the NHL level, TJ Brennan is going to outscore William Nylander.
Right?
It's just going to happen.
So that's, I mean, if TJ Brennan was smart, he'd re-enter the draft this year, wouldn't he?
Well, absolutely. And if William Nylander was smart, he would look at his work ethic, and that's how he would improve his game.
Yeah, exactly.
By the way,
no shot at TJ Brennan.
I saw on Twitter, ESPN tweeted out a link to an article that said, why you should draft Laine over Matthews.
Of course.
So obviously, you click the article to read it. So I go in, and this article is by Corey Pronman.
Oh, I've seen him before.
Oh, yeah.
Corey Pronman. It goes, the Pron Star. Between Matthews and Laine, top first overall pick. In creating my 100 draft rankings, I chose Laine.
Did you say why?
I want to keep reading.
Okay.
Must be ESPN Insider.
Nobody is an ESPN Insider.
No!
Who is paying for access to a website, Disney?
It's arrogant. It's. Oh, really? I'm going to pay to read your website. I guess I can't read anything now. There's nothing else on the entire internet.
Is it not possible to screen cap and or copy and paste the text on the page?
Yeah, but now you're just being Napster for... Poor old Corey Grumman.
Or your ESPN, and you could find other ways to generate revenue through website clicks.
Now, this is not a hit on Corey Grumman. He's been great. I've been following him for many years. I don't friggin' make me pay to read something. Mm-hmm. Don't do it. Just don't. And don't geoblock stuff.
Yeah.
That's even worse. Because it's
UFC, damn it.
True.
The UFC got caught geoblocking their own image the other day.
Good.
What? It said this is not available because of copyright laws, and it was a tweet from the UFC feed. Good.
Well, I always find it hilarious, too, when I go to watch, like, if I want to watch, say, a Jimmy Fallon clip for Kiss, and I go to the NBC website because that's the instant link, because American websites come up before Canadian ones do. There's just more of them, right?
Yeah.
And it'll let me watch the commercial, but it won't let me watch the actual segment. I'm like, so how does this geo-blocking thing work? I watched a Jeep commercial in all American dollars and all American financing options. That's cool. But watching everything else isn't.
Sure glad I watched my 20th consecutive Carl's Jr. ad. I think there's like one of those in the entire country.
So we're going to take a second. We're going to be right back on Sportsnet 590 The Fan with what is potentially the greatest piece of free writing I could ever throw at you.
Oh my goodness.
It's fabulous.
But I haven't written anything this week.
No, well, this is other than you.
Don't laugh, Jesse. How rude.
So this podcast is brought to you by Panago Pizza. It's what's on the inside that counts. I'm going to switch gears to Raptors and Cavaliers for a second. Because,
what?
And if you are a hockey fan, not from Canada, you don't quite understand how big this is that the Raptors are in the Final Four. That they're in the Eastern Conference Finals, that they've made it to the third round. There's a million ways to say it. It's incredible.
They have a 1 in 4 chance of winning the NBA championship.
Right.
It comes down to Oklahoma.
Well,
Cleveland.
Yeah.
Golden State.
And?
Other.
And thank you to CBS Sports for that amazing troll job. Now, as soon as that came out, I don't know if you know this, Raptor fans went nuts.
Oh, yeah.
So then they changed it to Raptors.
Yes.
And Raptor fans blew it up. And of course, you know, Raptors are going to win. And it's a CBS like sports poll. It's like CBSSports.com poll.
Oh, so then guaranteed it was a great traffic day for CBS Sports.
Amazing. Yep. So the best part of it is that CBS Sports, seeing all this, then reset the poll.
What? Oh! So other one then?
Well, no. They changed it to the Raptors, and the Raptors were winning, and then they reset the whole poll.
Because it was just too right.
Just because it was funny. Just because they know that we Canadians have an inferiority complex. They know. And they're using it against us.
So in the last 8 months, two Toronto professional sports teams have made it to the Final Four.
In the last 2 days.
Yeah, Marlies and the Raptors.
Blue Jays and Raptors is what we're going
for. And Marlies.
Oh.
And Marlies. It's pro hockey. They get paid.
Let's go Blue Jays and
Raptors. Wow.
So.
Well, now, Jesse, though. Oh, no, sorry. Were you about to make
a point? No, go ahead.
I was going to say, when was the last time there were two Game 7s on there were Game 7s on back-to-back days for professional sports teams in Toronto.
Well,
when was the last time?
If you ask Jesse, there hasn't been.
Well, it just hasn't happened yet. No, ever, yeah. Still hasn't happened.
Ever.
Fair enough.
Ever.
Who are these Marlboros? I don't know.
They're the Marlies.
Yeah. I don't think it has happened because unless the Leafs and Raptors
in 2001?
Playing Brooklyn, unless that was back-to-back?
No.
No, it couldn't have been because they start the playoffs at a different time, don't they? I don't think that's ever happened before.
I don't think that was same week. And maybe in 2001 or something like that.
I love how you guys are still counting the Marlies.
And baseball is inverse, right?
Shut up! Shut up, Jesse!
They're a minor league team.
They're not a minor.
They literally are.
No, they are literally a minor league team. Still professional, though.
Still professional.
They're professional minor leaguers.
Okay.
Yeah. Professional.
That's fair.
Professional still first.
We counted the Bisons, too.
Listen.
Okay.
They're the future. Okay.
Every game is a tryout, Jesse.
You take the road.
Conquer Calder.
There you go. Yeah.
Our moment. Come together.
Anyways, is the Toronto jinx over?
I don't think there ever was a Toronto jinx.
Gotta
I think
have
the
a championship.
Toronto jinx was the fact that all of our teams all at once for 15 to 20 years were all poorly managed.
Just
except
so,
for the Leafs at the end of the 90s and early 2000s.
Just so Argos and Furies and Toronto Rock fans, you know, don't scream at me too much. I'm talking MLB, NFL, MLB, NHL, NBA. talking those three. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
That's what I'm talking.
We're talking about the bigger sports. I think everybody
the big three.
And if you don't understand that, well, come on.
I'm not
giving those people credence. If you don't understand that, then you don't understand that. That's ridiculous.
We're not poo-pooing the others.
That's the
other. I would never poo-poo
okay,
them.
Okay, by not mentioning one thing doesn't mean we're taking a swipe at it, people. So if I get one tweet about that, I'm going to be so mad.
You know what, Adam?
What? Steve.
We're talking about the big three.
Hey, Steve.
And then there are the other leagues. You didn't even mention curling.
I know.
The other.
Right? Or lacrosse.
I mentioned lacrosse. Did you mention lacrosse? Just didn't care.
Hey, Steve, guess what?
What?
I think you have a nice shirt on.
That means you think my shirt is ugly.
Exactly, Jesse.
How dare you?
Steve,
are you
have
saying
a nice
every other shirt I own is crap?
This is what I'm talking. Welcome to Twitter. Welcome to Twitter.
What's wrong with my pants? Screw you, man.
Exactly.
Jesse, Adam's a dick.
He is.
I am.
I don't want to.
I am. This is that is the logic, but I want to read.
We're on the radio.
I can't say dick.
Can we say dick?
I think we can.
I'm not.
I guess we'll find out.
I guess we'll find out. We will find out.
Here's the. I think we've said it on Kiss, so I'm sure. Sure, we've said worse.
Please
on
email
Kiss.
Complaints at 5fan590.com.
Oh, good. You screwed up the.
That's great that
address.
You know the radio's your name too. Wow, this is going really well. All right, so I want to read a piece of copy that came out today.
A piece of copy.
That is newspaper terminology, my friend.
Oh my goodness, print media.
I know. Are you ready?
So ready.
No big league Toronto team has ever played a Cleveland team in the postseason at anything. The simple explanation is that Cleveland doesn't have a hockey club and Toronto's never been much good at anything else. But I'd prefer to think... But I'd prefer to think that this is God's way of keeping two immensely powerful negative forces from interacting and thereby ripping a hole in the Earth's crust.
Who wrote that?
Who do you think wrote that?
I don't know.
We're gonna play a game called
what
Who Wrote
is
That?
This?
Who could have wrote that?
Okay, American?
I'm not going to tell you who wrote that.
Oh,
you know them.
Hints.
You know. You know the person. So there's somebody that we've mentioned before.
Not Stevie Sidman.
No, not our boy Steve Simmons.
That was my guess.
That was okay. So are you both Steve Simmons on that?
Demi Cockman?
No.
No.
Kathy
Coleman.
Cathal Kelly.
Oh, friggin'. Can you read the first part again?
What is that?
No big league Toronto team has ever played a Cleveland team in the postseason at anything.
Okay, correct.
The simple
statement.
Explanation is that Cleveland doesn't have a hockey club, and Toronto's never been much good at anything else.
Toronto's never been much good at anything else, like winning back-to-back World Series in that league that definitely has a Cleveland team! Shut up!
I just thought you guys would really like that.
That's why I hate that. You can't just have an editor proofread your stuff. You need an editor that knows sports, and maybe goes, "You think that's a good idea? You think that? You think?
Do you think now in writing something like that? Is it the Jeremy Roenick theory? Is it he's trying to make entertaining?
I mean,
that's not journalism. That's just
I don't care.
That's just editorial.
Mute.
But.
Mute. Hey, you want to know what I think? Nope. Mute.
All right. Fine. I just thought I thought
rip a hole in the Earth's crust. Shut up. Oh my God. I hope this year's World Series somehow works out to be Blue Jays versus Indians. I know that's impossible. I don't care.
That's actually impossible. Yeah.
Yeah, I know that. One of the. A moment that bothered me when I was...
It bothered me when I was
a teenager, and I didn't like how much it bothered me. I knew I was being silly, but I didn't care. Remember when Conan O'Brien recorded like a week's worth of shows in Toronto in 2003?
Yes, that was great.
It was awesome.
And he had the CN Tower racing like contest. That was great.
And he had Ty Domi and Tom Fitzgerald on the ice with him.
Could have done better.
No, he couldn't have. They were the heart and soul of that team.
I forgot Tom Fitzgerald played for the Leafs.
They played for the professional hockey team that is in Toronto. He had Stompin' Tom Connors on.
Oh.
And he did good old hockey game. Mm-hmm. And then Stompin' Tom took a pause between one of the songs and he goes, "This year's Stanley Cup final is going to be between the New Jersey Devils." And the whole audience goes, "What?" And he goes, "And the Toronto Maple Leafs." And then they would go, yeah! They were just being polite because they're both in the Eastern Conference. And I think that whole audience for a sec was like, Stompin' Tom doesn't know how the playoffs were.
Right.
I didn't like how much it bothered me. I was just like, that can't happen. Stompin' Tom.
Had there been Twitter, you would have tweeted him.
Yo, that's so true.
You would have.
You know what? 2003 me would have been like, that's wrong.
Totally.
Can't happen. Why don't you just say they're going to play the Milwaukee Bucks? Why don't you just say that?
You'd have sent him a screen cap of the NHL conferences and then gone on a five-tweet tirade about
Leaf Seahawks, book it.
He would have taken a picture of Iggy and be like, Iggy knows more about the playoffs than you.
You know, it's funny too. I was at a Bon Jovi concert once, which is never how you should start a story. That's never a sentence that you want to say. But I've been to a Bon Jovi concert.
Who has a banner in the ACC?
Who has a banner? Yeah. Toronto legend, John Bon Jovi. Oh. By the way, remember all the concert acts that they were going to raise up to the rafters?
I guess they had a lot of pushback.
No, it's just going to be John. Just John. Thanks, Tim Leiwicki. That was the one weird thing that I did not agree with Tim Leiwicki. I know they were going for the NFL team at that point, and he was trying to woo John, but really, Tim Leiwicki?
That and re-signing really? Dave Nonis to 5 years.
Yeah. Anyway, I was at a John Bon Jovi concert, and he had this moment where it was, you know, it started with, you know, the song Cowboy, where he starts, and it's just him and the acoustic guitar, and all the steel horse I ride.
We know the song.
And then it was building up, and you could
Can
feel
you
it.
Can you sing more of it for
it, me? No. It was building up. The song ended. It was building up into Bad Medicine.
Oh, man.
Which is a good song, right? Good song. Ooh, man. Your love is like bad medicine. It's what I need.
Yeah.
Your kiss is what I need.
Oh, wow.
Lyrics in the song.
I figured.
And before he starts it, he wants to do a, by the power vested in me, almost like a marriage, right? So he says, by the power vested in me.
Oh, no. Oh, no. Oh, you can't even get
so
through
small.
It.
By the power vested in me by the people of the state of Ontario.
Oh!
And everybody in my row at the same time was like, no.
No.
And it's not a big deal. He's from the United States, right? He's used to saying state, even if it's a flub and he knew it was province, which he probably does because he's a pretty smart guy. Everybody was still like,
oh, he went on there and said, "Hello, Springton."
Yeah, that's exactly
what he did. Totally did. You're right. He totally did. It's funny when people get those little details wrong, and I understand when same thing with me when I get the hate tweets for getting all the little details wrong. It does irritate.
Did you know the Jersey is a popular Polish name, Adam? I bet you didn't. I hope you've read the 500 tweets you've received in the last week.
Whoa, I hope you guys got lit up.
Oh,
lit
my up goodness.
Was the tweet I got.
It's okay. Just send me the Polish podcast where they talk about, oh, Steve. You know how stupid that name is.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a nice shirt, Steve.
What are you saying?
I'm saying you have a nice shirt.
Josh Donaldson likes this shirt.
I know. I'm saying you have a nice shirt.
Do you want to promo that?
It's what I'm. It's what I'm not saying about Jesse.
Do you want me to mention that I interviewed Josh Donaldson?
Yeah, no. And by the way, don't worry.
Josh,
we're going to
Jesse.
Have clips of Steve's interview with Josh Donaldson on the next podcast.
Oh,
we're going to go through
it. Is that when your video is going to be up, Steve?
I don't know. Apparently,
no. We're gonna have clips. We're gonna
super
go
producer
this.
Adam Lyle.
You're gonna watch and see it. But I think you're gonna need to get the Steve Dangle podcast breakdown of Steve Dangle interviewing Josh Donaldson. Right? Mm. Do you not agree, Jesse?
I was proud of the job I did today. I was proud. Don't make me feel bad.
There's
about
a way.
Myself.
There's a way in which this show, I think, the three of us break things down that is different than just say watching a thing. Mm. Right?
Agreed. I think we could do something with that video.
So,
and it would be only to serve Steve and compliment him.
Yeah.
We've
only been ever nice to Steve. You know?
We forgot a moment that happened when I got into your clown car.
Do you want to explain?
I get in and I'm in his you know, 2016 coin purse. The smallest car I've ever been in. And I'm in it for like 2 seconds before I make the bump in my head comment. And Adam and Jesse start tearing into me. And so I go, there's no mics here. You can be my friends. Stop being mean to me.
And it's funny, with Andrew Berkshire later, we continued the drubbing. It was good.
Mm.
Hey, Do you guys want to hear a really interesting story? You guys are both like, you guys both would spend obscene amounts of money on jerseys and stuff, right?
Yeah, probably. Yeah.
Remember we were going through the AHL All-Star Game jerseys?
I just spent over $100 on figurines.
I own a Sam Bradford jersey. Pretty bad.
I own an Eddie George jersey. Oh, that was Adam's money.
I don't know which of you I hate more right now. You own a Sam Bradford jersey. You spent $100 on figurines.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think you hate me more because I got you a figurine one time and I never see it hanging in your home.
You know where it is? It was in our office probably here at work, garbage. And now it is in a box with the rest of my stuff because we no longer have an office here at work.
Oh, that just seems like overkill because it's still in a box. So now it's a box in a box.
Okay, I get it. I gotcha. Would you like to hear the next memorabilia thing? The next member, and I hope you guys haven't heard this story yet.
Is it Quarks?
Well, you remember that Ed Belfour sold his Olympic gold medal, right?
Yes.
Sold it for about $37,000, if my memory serves correct.
That's depressing.
It is a little depressing. You wonder very what's going depressing. On with Ed that he needs $37,000. Apparently, it's to start a company, but this is a guy who made like $18 million in the 3 years he played with the Leafs. So
he was also the third goalie. How much did it mean to him?
$18 million.
Dude,
dollars.
He made $6 million a year with the Leafs. Come on. $30,000 when you make $6 million?
Oh, yeah. All athletes from the 90s just spent their money on probably like stocks and bonds.
Yeah, sure.
And that's
of course,
the sad part.
Especially Ed. Especially Ed. That's what he's known for. Intelligent investing. Jim Craig. Do you know that name?
Jim Craig.
It's a plain enough medalist.
Name. Olympic medalist Jim Craig.
Yeah.
American? For the 1980 Miracle on Ice team.
Yeah.
That's it.
Jim Craig is selling his 1980 gold medal.
Oh.
I guess if you're Jim Craig, and you can make a little bit of money. I mean, he didn't have an NHL career. And even in the 80s, what were they making, right? Like, it wasn't that great.
Well, they were all amateurs on that team, weren't they?
They were.
Yeah.
They were. So, Jim Craig is selling this medal. How much do you think it is worth?
I'm going to go with more than Belfour's.
More than Belfour's.
I'm going to say more than Belfour's.
Even though Belfour's is more recent.
That's what makes it less valuable.
Okay.
The older something is, you know, it gains value.
Right.
It's like a house.
So put a number on it.
$50,000.
Solid. That's a lot of money.
It's a lot of money.
Jesse.
$100,000.
$100,000.
Wow.
So they haven't sold this at auction yet. But the estimates are between $5 and $7 million.
For just the medal?
Just the gold medal. Wow. And the thing that it hangs on.
Who buys that?
I don't know.
Collectors.
I don't know. That's a really good question. I know that there's been several things that have gone at auction recently, like somebody bought Paul Henderson's Team Canada 1972 jersey for a lot of money.
Hey, Adam, who buys figurines?
Right?
You know?
Honestly, it's just richer Steves. It's richer Steves. That's all it is. There's your answer. Richer you.
I hope one day I can resell them for 90 million bitcoins.
Now, he is also selling some other things from the Lake Placid Games. He is selling the jersey that he wore during the Soviet game.
Wow.
I don't know what that's estimated at. You would think that would be right up there with the gold medal.
Yeah.
I would pay more for that than the gold medal, to be honest with you. I just think it's cooler to look at. It's a cooler piece.
I hope someone buys it and wears it to like a rec hockey league game.
Yeah. And the American flag that was draped over his shoulders during the team's victory celebration. He is selling that too. Now that's a stretch. So Jim, why do you... Not Jim. So Steve, why do you have this flag in your basement? Because Jim no longer has it. Well, it's the flag that was draped over a guy that won a gold medal. Oh, was he an NHL guy? No, well, I mean, it was back. You ever heard of Miracle on Ice? Well, maybe. You need to watch the movie. It's really a great movie. But this is the flag that was draped over him after he won the gold medal.
Yeah.
That's a stretch.
You. How many times are you going to tell that story and the person is going to respond, oh, yeah, the movie?
Right.
Oh.
Or the little kid doing the speech, which is the viral video. Remember the little kid doing Herb Brooks' speech? Remember that little kid?
I'm sick of tired of hearing what a great hockey team the Soviets have. Screw them! I'm sick of tired.
Where is that kid now?
Still doing that speech, that poor kid.
Really?
They brought him out to so many sporting events in the months that followed. He did it at a Red Sox game, I'm pretty sure. Oh, yeah.
That's amazing. That is amazing.
And well, it's just like the movie.
Oh, sorry. Here we go. No, we got estimates. Okay. So by the way, for the gold medal, the pre-sale estimate, meaning if you wanted to buy it, I guess, is like 1.5 to 2 million.
It's just the medal.
Yeah, but they're saying It's estimated to bring in $5 to $7 million.
Oh,
The American flag is apparently worth somewhere between $1 and $1.5 million.
No, it is not.
And the American jerseys, same price range, $1 and $1.5 million.
Wow.
I could see the jersey being up there, but I could not see the flag being up there.
Devil's advocate. A Wayne Gretzky jersey. Mm-hmm. You would expect that to be worth a lot of money.
Yes.
Mario Lemieux.
Yes.
Gordie Howe.
Yes.
Maurice the Rocket Richard. Well, huge. Maybe not him because it was a while ago. But some of the more recent legends, maybe take Gordie Howe out of that equation, they wore more jerseys. They played pro hockey for 2 decades. Where are you going to get, you know, a Team USA jersey or any jersey with this guy on?
Well, especially the guy that mattered. I mean, Jim Craig was a big deal for them.
I haven't seen the movie.
Well, you need to see the movie. We got to wrap it up on Sportsnet 590.
I'm sick and tired of everyone telling me I need to see the movie.
It is the Steve Dangle podcast. On the download portion of the show, how much is $1 million in the NHL? How much is that really after all the things that you have to pay other people? When you see guys signing $1 million deals and you go, they'll be all right. Well, I think the answer is going to surprise you. Plus, our boy Vin Scully of the LA Dodgers is going to tell us another story.
Story time with Vince Scully.
You ready?
Awesome.
So how much is $1 million really? The Hockey News did a blog.
Blog.
On $1 million and what a Canadian player would make at $1 million. Now, Canadian players in Canadian money make $1.4 million because of the American exchange rate right now. This is what the article is saying. So it's...
That seems wrong, but okay.
Well, yeah, because you get paid in American dollars.
Yeah, but 1.4?
Yeah, because it's 80 cents on the dollar.
Wouldn't that be 1.2?
I don't know. Well, that's maybe at the time of this article, it was different.
Anyway,
okay,
anyway.
So let's say whatever. But for this article's sake, they're saying $1 million is $1 million.
Okay? More than a million.
When you make $1 million, the first thing you face is escrow. The collective bargaining agreement stipulates that 50% of hockey revenue must go to player salaries, and players are required to provide a certain percentage of their salary to the league to cover potential shortfalls. So 50% of the team's revenue's got to go to the players. Players have got to put their money into escrow just in case the league falls short on something. Mm-hmm. Fair. And there are teams that do. Currently, the escrow is at 18%.
Ooh. You get some of that escrow money back, though, don't you?
I think, I don't know how that, you know, that's a good question. I don't know how that works. Escrow is calculated after taxes, and players have always received some of that money back. There you go, Jesse. Not all of it.
Escrow was one of those words that, when it was getting thrown around during the lockout, I just, like NyQuil. I'm exactly. Like, I don't care. Just get on the ice, dude.
At that rate, a player would pay the NHL $180,000 and then keep their fingers crossed that the league is profitable. Ooh. So you're losing $180,000 right off the bat. Okay. Next comes tax, income tax. Okay. Having paid escrow, the player is now taxed at a rate in Canada, at least, and this is how bad Canadian taxes are, or how good. We do have a lot of good services. 50% of 100, say 820,000. Okay, so you've taken 180 grand off. You're at 820. Now you got to pay 50% of that in taxes. Where does that leave you? 410 grand. So this $1 million is slipping away really quickly. Players then pay their agents between 3% and 6%, depending upon the amount of services provided by the agent. That, let's say, at 4% is $34,000. They try to, and this article is based on a guy that tries to teach NHL players how to budget. He tries to keep them to $70,000 a year for hockey-related expenses, such as agent fees, personal trainer, disability insurance, trainer tips, supplements, workout equipment, etc. Okay? Mm. So there's another 70 grand. Well, I guess it's 34 times 2, basically.
Yeah. For the guys making a million, I guess that's reasonable.
At the end of it all, you're left with somewhere in the neighborhood, and this is off of $1 million, $240,000.
And I'm going to feel bad for a guy making $200,000.
I am not saying that you should. I'm not saying that you should. But if you ever move in next door to an NHL player, who is, you know, a guy who's the third or fourth line guy, don't be surprised if he's got just as much money as you do. And that's the thing. Think about a guy that's...
I've got $200,000 a year?
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, you know, he's just, you know, they're just one of us.
I am just saying, for a guy that's worked his whole life...
Jesse and I, we look at fourth line players and we go, hello, Pierre.
I just moved in right next to you.
Hi. Oh, you like Libvig as well. Yeah. I see.
Well, that's what it would like. That's where they would
Tom
live.
Tom Fitzgerald lives next to me in Oshawa.
I'm just saying, $1 million isn't actually $1 million.
Of course.
Mm. And that's that, that. I thought that was a really interesting article. You can check it out on thehockeynews.com. You know, listen, if any of us had 75% of our salary taken away before it even got home,
die.
Think about that. That's a lot of money.
It's wouldn't seem fair. Wouldn't seem American. I just wanted to sound like the guy from that car ad.
Anyway, I thought that was a really interesting.
It's not just unfair. It's un-American.
And I knew you guys would be like, "Oh, 240 grand." Blah 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 blah.
I saw a video. I don't know if it's recent or anything, but it's about how Shaq spent $1 million in 24 hours.
Whoa, really?
Or something like that. Well,
that's
it was hard. Well, it was like one of his first contracts, and he's like a. I walk into a dealership, I got a Rolls Royce, whatever. I brought it home, my dad's like, where's mine? And I'm like, you're right. So I brought him in, I bought him a car, then I bought my mom a car, and then blah, 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 blah. And he's going, you know, and there were all these agents out there telling me, oh, you got to give me, you know, your $40 million, and I'll put it here, I'll put it there, I'll make it grow, blah, 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 blah. And I didn't like all that. And then I met this little Jewish man. Who told me to put my money into stocks and bonds and savings accounts and I could claim this and, you know, claim this for my family and I would get a rebate on that. And I was like, shalom.
That's a great story. Wow.
You got to see the whole video. But he basically explains how, like, this one guy he trusted his money to basically, you know, kind of saved him financially from being like all the other
athletes who are,
you know,
broke.
So many pro athlete stories.
That's what I mean.
Where you go. You almost feel, I know what Jesse's saying, like you shouldn't feel bad for someone who makes that amount of money, but when you know what they could have made, mm-hmm. or if they're retired, what they could have done with that money.
Yes.
Like when you hear things like Mike Tyson's broke or something like that, which I don't think he is anymore, but like.
He should never be broke, by the way.
That gives me heart palpitations, man. How do you make that much money and then lose it all?
What if his house is just sitting abandoned now? Right now, apparently. It was like a $10 million house is just sitting there.
How does that happen?
And I think they're turning into a church or something. Like, it's huge. It's huge.
I'm going to pass out. How do you blow that much money?
And that's...
Well, he had a tiger. He should have a whole zoo of tigers for the amount of money he made. Holy smokes! How do you lose that much?
What was he making, like $50 million a fight or something? Like, weren't they...
A lot! A lot dollars. A lot of money.
Do you want to switch to story time with Vince Scully?
I would. That will make me feel better. Less palpitations.
I guess there's some Dodgers now that are growing beards. So this is not a new clip. It's about 2 weeks old. But Vin, being Vin, and there's a lot of games in the baseball season, right? There's a lot going on. So Vin has got to pick little things, being in that booth all alone. Pick little things out and tell stories about those things.
There are so many baseball games in a season that a bunch of Blue Jays and Rangers are going to get suspended who have played since they did the thing that they're going to get suspended for.
Yeah, there's that many games. It's true.
There's just too many games. You can't wait.
You got to hear this because he talks about
I think so.
The story of beards.
I'm not going to do it now because there's two out and the base is empty, but sometime during the game, if you've been like the way I have been, looking at players with these big beards, I decided I'm going to do a little research on beards. So
as one
during
does.
The game, yeah, there's plenty of them around. We'll tell you a couple of stories as we go through it. Two down, second inning, no score.
And who is changing the channel right now?
And first
no
pitch,
one.
Fastball, no first right. First of all, they say way back to the dawn of humanity, beards evolved, number one, because ladies like them.
Nice.
All right, we'll continue.
Do you think? Wait. Do you think you get to a certain age where you're like, anything I say will be hilarious?
I just think it's funny that Vin had found time to do all this research on beards because he goes deep. Check it out.
It was the idea of frightening off adversaries and wild animals. It's the one strike pitch, swung on and missed strike two.
Oh, by the way.
In fact, it was so serious, if you look it up, there's a divine mandate for beards in Leviticus and Deuteronomy.
What?
No balls and two strikes, they count. Stripling from the first base side of the rubber. Strike two pitch to Norris is promptly hit into right field, and it lands in front of Kike for a base hit.
And you don't even care about the game at this point.
A two-out single to right, and that will bring up Jamile Weeks.
It's a hit in baseball. It might not even turn into anything.
Exactly.
There became a time where Greek dramatists mined the popular prejudice against clean-shaven men. Back then, clean-shaven men were looked as the, maybe effeminate. And then along came Alexander the Great. That's another story. Alexander the Great was not only great, but he also thought he was the greatest looking man in the world. Oh, absolutely.
Oh, absolutely.
Hold on, the pitcher's about to throw.
Rippling ready, delivers, gets a strike. And Alexander the Great said, there is no reason to cover up my beautiful face with a beard. And so all of a sudden, it started to disappear.
Anyway, this goes on for 5 minutes. 5 minutes he calls a game. And the way he tells that story, tell me that if you were in this room right now, would you not say to him, my goodness, I'm spellbound by you. I just want to hear him tell stories.
If I was watching that game at home and someone tried to talk to me, I'd be like, shh, shh, shh.
Vin's talking.
Vin is telling me about beards.
We are witnessing the last season of undoubtedly the best baseball caller of all time, one of the best broadcasters in human history. And I hope if you're in LA and you have the right cable, because I don't think they're on Comcast. I think it's like there's like one cable company that they signed with and you can only get it on that cable company. And then the other one you can't. You see, so there's half the LA residents aren't seeing Dodger games. If you get the chance, you watch as many LA Dodger games this year as possible.
I'm going to a Dodgers game
this year.
Jay's Dodgers. Yeah. It's in Toronto, but yeah, we already got the
tickets. Already here, weren't they? Are they coming back?
Coming back.
Wow. Okay. Nice. Cool. Jesse?
It'll be my third Dodgers game.
You have our NHL bracket challenge up, do you not?
Yes. I was looking for you, Adam, mm-hmm. but I've gone to page 24 of the bracket challenge and I still haven't reached where you are in the standings.
I'm not really surprised.
So you'll have to sign in.
By the way, we have 24 pages?
No, we have 2.
How many people per page?
Entries?
What? I didn't know it was that big.
We have 2,720 entries.
I'm probably right at the bottom. So I'm not even kidding.
Wow. Who is in last place?
Dead freaking
Let's
last.
Point and laugh
last
at them.
I'd have to jump off. Hold on.
It's worth it to humiliate them.
I can't go yeah, that well, far. We'll, yeah, it'd take me a little bit.
We'll let Twitter humiliate him. It's probably me.
I'll pull up Steve's bracket here. I found him on the list. Your username isn't Steve Dangle, correct?
I'm pretty sure it's This Is Steve Dangle because someone already took Steve Dangle. Could you look at what I picked?
Yeah.
Which Steve Dangle will do better?
Oh my God.
So this is Steve Dangle sitting in 286th place.
Not bad.
Out of the amount of teams.
You're top 10 percentile almost.
By the way, how much do our listeners suck at this? Both the teams I had going to the final are out.
Wow. Okay. I didn't know that being 288th place gave you the right to be a little bit arrogant about your picks there,
I don't know if you heard, but I'm top 10%.
Jesse, where are you at, buddy?
I am 698th.
Ooh.
Yeah. Ooh. But out of 2,000, not bad.
Not bad.
yeah, Steve, you had
I mean, it's no 280, whatever, but... Sorry, what?
You had Anaheim and Washington in the finals.
Yeah, that's me. Okay. Great.
You got St. Louis in the conference finals, and that was the last time you... gain points. Oh, no, you had Tampa also in the conference finals.
Woo! I didn't have Pittsburgh. Oh, yeah, no, I guess not.
I'm going to try and go look for myself.
Yeah, so if you want to log in, you can pull up yourself. But yeah, we did not do too well. this time around.
Who's first?
First is Yo-No.
Yo-No?
Yo-No.
Yo-No.
Yo-No. How is Yo-No doing?
They have. Give me 1 second.
I would assume they would have. There's a say hi to Phil.
Yo-No has Pittsburgh and San Jose in the finals.
They have all of the final four.
They're perfect in the final four.
Did they get any wrong?
Throughout the entire playoffs, it looks like they might have a perfect bracket. They have a perfect bracket right now. Wow.
Wow. Wow.
They did not get Nashville over Anaheim in the first round. They have one incorrect guess.
Wow.
So, do you want to know how mine went? Do you want to know how
it.
I,
yes,
how
yes,
I did?
Let's hear it.
I am currently in 1,028th.
So hey, top half,
right? We'll take it. I got 46 points in the first round and 25 in the second and 0 in the conference finals this far.
And you can't get any more points.
I probably can't get
any
more points.
Do you have any of the final four? Didn't you have Detroit?
I have Pittsburgh and Tampa in the final. No, I have Washington, but I did take Tampa, so I have one in the final four.
Okay, hey. So I could still get points.
Of course, Tampa.
Did you know Tampa's
Adam's second team?
I did not know that. No, he's never mentioned that before.
Oh, my God.
Has Adam spent time in Tampa?
Did he?
Has he been to a game?
What does he think of the fans in Tampa? Are they great?
I don't think he thinks they're great.
Okay,
no.
All right. Hey, you know what is great?
Skate architecture.
What? Steve, I was going to say skate to great, but Steve was making fun of me because I was like, guys, architecture. I like architecture.
I'm a big fan of architecture.
Shut up.
Where do we text?
What?
Where do we text?
Oh, Dangle to 41010. Make a donation. It's a good thing to do. Shall we do the press conference?
The first question comes from a YouTube video, which Adam will click because I sent it to him on Facebook, above the
we have a YouTube.
Jeremy Roenick.
Okay, hang.
So you click that one, and we'll get our first question. I haven't
above
heard it
the
yet.
Jeremy Roenick?
Yes. Yeah, one link above that.
Not seeing it.
No, it's right there. So
good job. Good effort, everyone.
Whenever Adam clicks that.
I'm telling you, I can't see it.
I haven't heard that yet.
Oh, here it is. It didn't show up before. Okay. There it is. I reloaded the page and it was there.
Things magically appear, I guess, in Facebook.
I guess it does, Jesse.
Loves architecture, hates technology.
Greetings, Steve Dangle Podcasts, hosts, listeners, and fans alike. I am Fretzaw, a.k.a. Chopper on YouTube.
What up, Chopper?
You may remember me from such features as the spinal fusion surgery guy and guy who ate pepper to ask Steve a question. This time I have another good one for you. But first, I'm just going to have a little bit of a drink, if you don't mind, Steve.
What's he drinking?
Out of a pepper cup.
Ew! Oh, my God! He had a drink out of a pepper?
Yeah.
Oh, my God! That's the...
Chopper, you rule, buddy.
I'm just thinking of and Jesse's
changing
doing the camera. Oh my.
All right.
That's
go.
The nastiest shit I've ever seen.
Neither did I. Stands for pepper.
Sorry,
neither
hold
did
on.
I. Did you know that the P in IPA stands for pepper? Neither did I.
Did you get a beer?
Is that a
question to you is which Canadian city, town, or even village would be the best bet for another OHL franchise?
Hmm.
Dangle Navy, y'all.
Good question.
Hmm. Belleville.
Dangle Navy, what up? Belleville's a good one.
Sounds like they might get one. I think, was there a rumor of the Flint Firebirds moving to Belleville? I feel like there were. I know the Oshawa Generals would probably dig that because I think they would automatically be the closest team to the Gens. Easiest drive, probably. Or no, probably still Peterborough, then Belleville. It's hard because how doesn't Toronto have one?
I think there's enough hockey here.
Yeah.
I think the entertainment dollars are split enough.
I've told the story 1,000 times, but I'll go ahead and tell it again. Our friend Al from Aberdeen, mm-hmm. Aberdeen,
the guy who wrote your theme song.
Yes. He went out to Halifax and, you know, with CDs and shirts and stuff and merch, and they ran out.
Mm-hmm. I was there at a show.
Oh, that's right. That's when you were there. Yeah.
Yeah,
and
we went
you ran out of shit.
Yeah.
Because it's what I told you about Saskatoon. There's nothing to do, and everyone's at the nothing.
It was a great nothing to be at.
There's
by the
a band in town. Well, let's fucking go.
Yeah.
Let's go. We're going to go and we're going to have a good time. Toronto, there's 1,000 bars, 1,000 everything going on. You know, if I don't go see the Leafs, I can go see the Marlies. If I don't go see the Marlies, I can see the Furies. If I don't go see the Furies, I can see the Rams. If I maybe want to change a pace, I could do basketball.
Yeah.
I could see the 905. I could see TFC. I could see the Jays. I could see the Argos. I could see the Rock.
There's a lot.
There's a lot of options.
And the thing is, too, Torontonians, while I love this city, are not the warmest people. And they tend to be, from time to time, a little bit snooty about what they like. And I'm definitely guilty of this, not being a huge curling fan. But I think there's a... what? I'm just not. But I think that there's an expectation here of... It's pro sports or it's nothing. I mean, this is a town that claims to be hockey mad, but didn't show up to the Marlies games until this year. Even though they've been to the Calder Cup.
The last few years, they've been strong.
Stronger.
But it took a few years to get above 4,000.
Yeah. And you've been there when it's been less. And I think that's the point is that, you know, I think it's an OHL team here. I just don't think it's needed. I could see a North York team. But I can't see a Toronto Central team.
I could see something east of the city and north of the city because they're doing a lot of developing, actually kind of in my area, the whole 407, and there's a new highway going northbound too. And I know housing prices are going up and everything's going up. I think they're building a huge mall there. So they're developing that kind of area. So maybe there, potentially there. I'm trying to think of another Ontario town that doesn't have an OHL team.
Well, Mississauga has the Steelheads.
They have the Steelheads, and their attendance is not good.
Yeah. And then Brampton had a team for the longest time. They don't have one anymore.
Brampton's another... I think it's kind of a microcosm of, Ontario, you know? Mm-hmm. And they have two hockey teams. They got the Brampton Thunder, and they got the Brampton, help me, Beast of the ECHL.
Oh, right. Okay. Yeah, we have an ECHL team in Brampton.
Yeah.
Never been to a game.
Makes a lot of sense.
Most of us have never heard of them.
I don't think we need a downtown team. It doesn't seem necessary.
I think we can't look at the GTA. I think we're...
No. Yeah.
But then the problem is so many of them are in that, you know, 2 hours or less outside of the GTA little bubble.
Mm-hmm. And a lot of those cities that could support an OHL team are already have one.
Yeah.
I mean, even Ottawa's got a team, and Kitchener, and
Kingston
and Guelph,
Sudbury,
and, you know, like
Sault Ste. Marie.
Mm-hmm. We got enough hockey.
Thunder Bay, but that's in Thunder Bay.
Thunder Bay. And that's really, really hard as far as travel goes. Ontario, you have to understand, is enormous.
People don't understand, people who aren't from here will not believe this, but go ahead, punch it into Google Maps. Ontario from the bottom tip to Winnipeg. That's 24 hours.
Yes.
That's a 24-hour drive.
Yeah, if we drove to Winnipeg right now, we would barely be there by this time tomorrow.
We might not.
We might not.
If we had to stop.
And go to the bathroom.
If we wanted to sleep and not die.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I got nothing. I'm sorry. I wish I had a more interesting answer for that.
It's an interesting question, just not one that we've got. Jesse, do you have another question? I know you're looking at the camera right now because the camera is cutting out. Something going on? Technical
issues. I don't
think
it helps if I talk from over here.
Okay.
Okay, fair enough.
Fair enough.
Here, you want me
Steve,
to go
that's
on
a
his
very
laptop?
Nice shirt. You have a very nice shirt, Steve.
Oh,
No, don't look at the questions. No. Don't do it.
None of these are good.
That's rude.
Wow.
Oh, wait. Were those not the ones you were going to ask?
Yeah. Okay. It was on my phone. Okay. Sal says, is it sad that I'm the only hardcore hockey fan in my school?
Where does Sal go to school?
I don't have any more details.
See, you got to say that. You know what? I talk at RH King Academy almost every year because my friend is a teacher there. And every year, there's practically no hockey fans.
Mm-hmm. It's an expensive sport. Hockey is pricing.
Mid Scarborough.
If I had the NHL, I would be. You know what I would do as a business move? If I'm the NHL, instead of starting all these charities, I start my own NHL brand hockey gear and I make it very affordable.
Mm. What an interesting little idea.
The second you make hockey affordable again, because it used to be very affordable to play.
But even then, it was when it was more affordable, it was never as affordable as a bat and a ball.
Yeah, or a ball in a basket.
or a ball in a basket.
Or a ball in two lunch boxes at recess. Mm. True. Hockey's always going to be more expensive, but because we're in Canada, you know, there is the winter element and that sort of thing. But if I was the NHL, I would come up with like a generic brand NHL everything, not do any markup on it, like have very little profit, and what profit you do have goes into reinvesting. And you create a market for people that can't afford it. Quite honestly, if I had a child right now, it would be a stretch to put them in hockey. It really would.
Same. Well, and just the time.
The time and the time money. Education. The money is crazy. The money's crazy. And, you know, why are we paying, why are kids paying 20 and 30 grand or even 10 grand to play hockey for a season? That's insane.
We know two guys, the Jones brothers, they both were like, hey, you want to play AAA? And they were just, well, how much is it? Oh, no.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
the best hockey player who ever lived may have never played in the OHL. You know what I mean? Or, like, maybe never played, like, Canadian Major Junior, maybe never even made a career of it.
Yeah.
Because they just decided, nope, that's way too much.
And I understand the business practices for CCM and for Bauer and for everybody else who makes equipment, and they'd probably be pretty mad at the NHL for doing that. But we need, or, you know, maybe the NHL doesn't do this, and if you're an entrepreneur right now listening, here's an idea. Come up with a discount brand but extraordinarily safe hockey product. Mm-hmm. And, you know, passes all the tests, does all the same things that CCM, Bauer, Nike, whoever, Reebok, whoever else makes hockey gear, does all those things, only you're not charging through the nose for it. And I'm sorry, you don't need a $200 stick and you don't need $1,000 skates. It's just crazy. And that's what's pricing people out of the market.
Steve, we were talking about this at the ball hockey tournament because you had a stick that cost $500 and you picked it up for $75.
Yeah, the Leafs kind of got wise to that. So every year the equipment sale used to be like a great deal.
Yeah,
I got Tim Brent's game used gloves, and I think it was $125, and I got his game used stick for $75, so it's a grand total of $200, which is still a lot of money. But Jesse, you felt them. It was like paper.
Yeah, they were nothing.
They were both like paper. The stick is easily $250, $300, and it was slightly used. And the gloves, yeah, they had a couple holes in them or whatever. But it's, you know, it's mostly for the outside.
And you can always get that fixed if you're so inclined.
Of course. And again, those gloves in store, $200, $300.
Yep. Instead of a player on the NHL skating around with $2,000 on them.
At least. Yeah. The skates are about $500. Stick is about $300.
Pants are
helmets. Probably what, $200? Pants, shoulder pads
for $200. You know these
gloves.
Like, it's like Beats headphones. They cost $14 to make. Mm-hmm. Why do people buy them?
How expensive do you think an NHL player's jock is? I'm gonna go with $50 at least.
But then you compare it to other.
However,
sports,
at anything. The NHL level, I get it. I get that. I don't get a $50 jock unless it's gold plated.
No, but even at the
professional,
if you were
facing you and massages you afterwards.
If you had to block a Zdeno Chara shot, you would believe in a $500 jock.
Yeah, okay, fair.
But even at the professional level in the NBA or in professional soccer, they're still walking around with $80 on them.
True. Yeah.
The jerseys, well, maybe more.
They would charge.
I'm sure the shoes are expensive or whatever, but
it's not that much. It's affordable. It's not $3,000.
Well, and that's going to be the biggest challenge of the NHL now, because people's money is getting tighter and tighter and tighter. And as you see the middle class disappearing, and it's you know, not to get too political, but as you see that happen, it was the rank and file average people like us who supply these leagues with players. Mm-hmm. And now it's becoming, well, now you're seeing players' kids come in and rich kids come in, and that's it.
Yep. Oh, so much nepotism in the NHL and in professional hockey.
And so be it. There's nepotism everywhere. But
yes, but like, it's getting ridiculous now. Like, every draft, it used to be like, oh, it's so-and-so's nephew. And now, no. You know who can afford to put their kid through enough hockey to have them make the NHL? Former NHL players. That's it. And they really didn't even start making money. Like, mm-hmm. good money until like the last 25 years or so. It's gonna get worse. Mm-hmm. Stories like Michael Bunting, I don't think will happen very much. And sorry, Jesse, that's why I forgot his name. Fourth round pick of the Arizona Coyotes in 2014. Michael Bunting, he went to, what's that big athletic school in Scarborough? I always forgot. Birchmount. He went to Birchmount. And he played Double A for the longest time, and he was like the sickest player in Double A.
Was he short?
I think so. Let me look it up. Hockey DB.
Is he our age?
No. He's 95. Michael Bunting, he says he's 6 foot tall.
Okay.
191.
Okay.
Anyway, he played Double A, was like the sickest player, couldn't afford Triple A. He just couldn't. And so finally they go, all right, this is your last year that you can play Triple A. We'll do it. Sure enough, Kyle Dubas is at one of his games, or one of the scouts for the Sault Ste. Marie Greyhounds is at one of his games. The Sioux Greyhounds give him a home. He plays for them in the OHL. He plays well enough that the Coyotes took a flyer on him in the fourth round. But I don't think that's going to be a common story anymore. And it's a story I love. I love the Wayne Simmonds story. The Wayne Simmonds story is fantastic.
It's unbelievable. Yeah.
But it's so... The reason it's fantastic is because it's so hard to do what he did. And mm-hmm. It's going to get to the point where it's going to be teetering
maybe,
on impossible.
Maybe that's our million-dollar idea there, fellas. Start coming up with hockey gear that people can afford. I'm serious. It's like, it would be nice if somebody could. And by the way, we as a show would totally rep you guys. We would rep you.
Totally.
So I wonder if that's where the market is for the next generation and where you find young kids again. So hopefully that's the case. Do we have one more question?
Yes. If the league added two more compliance buyouts, who should the Leafs buy out?
Well, Joffrey Lupul, no question. And then,
but you could just stick him on IR and say,
well,
that
could
buyout.
You then? He might make a stink at that point.
You could, or you could just buy him out.
Yeah.
And it makes it go away. I mean, you're paying him regardless, right? And then I don't think he takes up a roster spot.
That's part of it, right? And that's the thing now. The Leafs, Mike Babcock said that in an interview yesterday. He's at the World Championships, and he said, you know, I don't think we're going to be signing guys come free agency. Now, he might just be trying to throw us off because he's like, we have too many guys. We have too many contracts. And don't be surprised if you see another Grabner deal happen.
That's also Babcock.
He didn't say that. I did, but.
That's also, well, and you know what? I'm gonna write something soon. And I hate to put these guys' names out there because they're in the middle of a playoff run. But, like, okay, for example, I think Peter Holland will be dealt to the draft. He's obviously not in the middle of a playoff run. But other RFAs include Garrett Sparks, mm-hmm. who's currently riding Pine. Stuart Percy, former first-round
pick.
Isn't
Victor Louvre? Josh Levo?
I don't remember if Victor Louvre is, but Josh Levo sure is. AHL All-Star Josh Levo sure is. I think... Some of the guys they think might have been passed in the organizational depth chart might be on their way out. And it's not even because they're bad players, but it's because of the problem that you just said. They have too many guys.
Yep.
One more thing.
Yep.
Did you know that Wendell Clark's Muskoka home is on Airbnb?
It's beautiful, by the way.
What?
Do you know how much it costs per night?
So wait, I can just chill at Wendell Clark's place.
Wendy Clarkman's.
Fire up Airbnb?
For one night?
Parts. One night. How much it costs?
And where is it? It's in Muskoka?
Muskoka, yep. Muskoka Cottage. This is his summer home.
For sure, over a grand.
What's your guess?
$1,500.
Adam.
For one night. It's Muskoka and it's huge. So definitely, it's definitely
bananas. That's for bananas.
Like a richer family. It needs to be like incredible. A big family weekend. And they would probably avoid selling to, like, frat parties.
$5,000.
For one night!
Per night. Do you know the rules? That
you would have to throw a kegger to raise enough money. You would have to throw a Muskoka kegger.
It accommodates 15 people, has 10 bedrooms.
Oh, forget it.
8 bathrooms.
Mm-hmm.
Bookings require two...
What cottage has 8 bathrooms?
Bookings require 2-night minimum stay. So you got to spend $10,000.
No, that's gotta. It's gotta be five grand for the two.
If he gets a long weekend, if he gets a couple long weekends, he's covered his expenses for the year.
Done.
It's brilliant.
Yeah,
absolutely brilliant.
Mm-hmm. It's Wendell Clark's place.
Brilliant.
Do you want to hear the rules?
Yeah.
That come on the Airbnb listing.
No keggers.
No mini sticks in the house. Mustache trimming is allowed. Shaving is not. Help yourself to anything in the fridge or cupboards. Just don't touch the Cap'n Crunch. Keep your head up at all times, especially on the dock. Now, Zamboni parking is permitted.
Why are you being cute, Wendell?
No diving, unless it's off the dock.
Ah, you see, because water.
And no smoking, no events or parties. Pets are welcome.
Who is not throwing a kegger at Wendell Clark's Muskoka Cottage?
He's not playing a game of mini sticks in Wendell Clark's
Cottage. And then posing with the keg above your head like it's the Stanley Cup.
If it was going to be cheap, I was going to say, why don't we rent it for the night and do a podcast up there?
But
oh, but no.
Could
event?
We raise $10,000?
I wouldn't want to raise $10,000 to do
pay
that.
Wendell
no,
Clark.
I gotta
not
say,
a chance in heck. I'd rather raise $10,000 and go for something good.
Yeah.
Speaking of which, I gotta say thank you to everyone who donated to our Pave the Way team.
What did we raise?
Oh, I thought you were going to say we won, and we didn't. We lost by one goal in the final.
Yeah, we
Natalie
lost
Spooner.
To Natalie Spooner's team.
More like Natalie Gooner. Yeah. I saw she was bullying you, Adam.
She was. We got into it in the corners. And I found out Natalie Spooner, much stronger than me. Weird. Not weird at all. Expected that. Tried to hold my own. Couldn't.
Very competitive.
Yes.
We had Laura Fortino on our team.
Oh my God, Laura is competitive.
A little bit more competitive.
Yeah. One of the players on one of the other teams rattled her a bit. And to kind of get her back down to earth, I made it funny. I made her laugh. I said, hey, you know what Fortino means in Italian?
Mm-hmm.
Sick player.
And her boyfriend Mike was there too, playing on our team. And
we used to play on the Sarnia Stadium.
I heard him say, calm down, Laura, a couple times.
We also had Jessica O'Grady too.
She passed it to him and he scored. And I was like, guys, that goal was adorable. And they didn't say anything to me. And I thought, they probably don't like me very much right now. And by the way, shout outs to Jeffler.
Who's the sickest ball hockey player ever.
I've never seen. Yeah. If you want a ringer for your ball hockey team, Jeffler's the guy to call.
Fortino kept going like, oh my God, Jeff!
He
told me yesterday, I sat next to him in the Marlies press box, he thought she was kidding.
No.
He thought she was, no. There was a time where it was like O'Grady, Fortino, and Sarnia Stingboy. Out
Mike
there.
DiPaolo, yes.
And I had, Mike DiPaolo. I just wanted to call him that. And I had more faith that we would get a goal with Jeff out there.
Yeah.
He's just a sick ball
He's
hockey
a
player.
Sick
He's
ball
just
hockey
really
player.
Good.
For sure. Anyway,
but we raised over $6,000 as a team.
Thank you so much for all your donations. $6,000.
I got a couple donations over $100. I was $105 shy the morning of the event, and someone's like, here's $105.
Nice.
I did not make my goal. I made my first goal, but then I set a second one, and people were like, no, we're done with you.
Didn't you, like, set three different goals?
No, I set it to 5, and I got it, and then I set it to 1,000, and I didn't get it.
Oh, well, thanks for helping me hit 1,000. Thanks for helping our team hit over 6.
It's amazing. Mm-hmm.
Very, very, very cool.
Congratulations.
Hopefully next year's event can be bigger.
Yes.
And not with sleet and hail.
It
and
did snow. It was the most
the
Canadian
snow.
Day.
That was nice.
I don't know about you guys. I'm still sore from it, too. I'm still totally
Jeff,
sore.
Jeff could not walk yesterday.
Wow.
It's aggressive.
It's from giving 110%.
Yeah, that's right. If the three of us had been trying hard enough, we'd have had trouble walking too.
Also, drinking pop between games.
Yeah.
You idiots.
See, maybe you should chug Diet Pepsi.
Yeah.
Just an idea. Anyway, we're going to be back on Thursday. So we've got a couple games in the NHL to watch out for, the beginning of the Marlies series, and the Raps and Cavs tonight. And if you're cheering for anybody other than Toronto, you're wrong.
Oh.
You're wrong.
Absolutely.
You're basically
Was that up
wrong.
For debate?
I think so. I think some people would debate you
Disagree.
On that.
Disagree.
Disagree.
Those Josh Donaldson videos will be up eventually. There's going to be 3 to 5 videos out of the 12 delightful minutes I got to spend with him.
Which we will break down.
And
detail.
Talk about how great they are.
Yeah, absolutely. I can't wait. Jesse?
I know excited? You
can't. Oh, I'm just glad that Josh Donaldson plays for a professional team, unlike Victor Lee.
Oh!
Wow!
Follow the guys on Twitter at Steve_Dangle, at Adam WYLDE, and at Jesse Blake.
The Steve Dangle Podcast. Brought to you by Panago Pizza. Order at panago.com and stuff your face with deliciousness.